Hello, lovely internet strangers. Welcome to the next video in my series discussing The Fraud of Feminism by Ernest Belfort Bax. This time we're talking about female criminals and some crazy shit they've done. The author was an English barrister, so he knows what the fuck he's talking about. I'm not gonna try to fact check some of the cases that he presents because they're really old and obscure, but let's just enjoy talking about these stories and a general discussion of how female criminals were treated under the law in England in 1913. So Bax says that English libel laws actually prevent him from speaking of individual cases of acquittal of females guilty on the evidence, but that he could show a disparity in punishment. For example, a 19-year-old male getting executed on doubtful evidence for murdering his sweetheart versus a woman being reprieved after being convicted on her own admission for the murder of her lover by soaking him in paraffin during his sleep and setting him on fire. The woman turned the man into a literal human candle. She confessed, and then she was acquitted. What the actual fuck? This was a story in this book that made me go, women are wild. And I had to run out of the bedroom and go tell the whole story to my husband because I had just lost my ability to can. So that's my favorite story from this book. Bax shares another story about a nurse who sued her ex-fiancé for breach of promise, which I discussed in a previous video. That is the concept of a woman being owed money if the man broke off the engagement, even if it was justified. So this nurse sued her ex-fiancé for breach of promise and got £100, even though she had thrown sulfuric acid on him and he hadn't prosecuted her, and she had been involved with another man. That is goddamn wild. Whereas a man who threw sulfuric acid on a woman was sentenced to 12 years of penal servitude. Another great story. A woman who shot at a postman who fired point blank at his head. Luckily, he managed to kind of dodge and the bullet just grazed his head, but she was found not guilty, even though she was found with the revolver cocked and two chambers empty. Imagine that being your life. Yeah, we know that this woman shot you point blank and we have the evidence, but she's not gonna be punished for it. Anyway, so Bax talks about the influence of sentimental feminism, that there's this unwritten law that horrible crimes could be excused because it was dictated by a desire to avenge a woman's honor or to enable her to obtain the object of her wishes, and that the treatment of the crimes of the suffragettes was only a slight exaggeration of the general immunity that women experienced from all the more severe penalties that should be placed upon them according to the law. He gives an example of the suffragettes being given light treatment for willful damage and arson. The suffragettes asserted that English law made a distinction between political and non-political criminals, but this was never a thing until Winston Churchill, as the Home Secretary, made a prison ordinance just to please suffragettes, and that if a group of anarchist men had been doing the same thing, people would be indignant, they would be proposing the harshest punishments, but not so with the suffragettes. Everyone's like, oh, it's fine, they're women. The suffragettes would burn things and destroy property and try to claim special privileges for a political act. And Bax holds this as an example of the extraordinary influence of feminism over the modern mind, that people are willing to look the other way on arson and property destruction just because the people doing it are women. He mentions a woman who stole and then justified it by saying she thought her engagement wouldn't lead to marriage, and so she got depressed and therefore couldn't be held responsible for her actions. And the punishment was mitigated because she wouldn't be able to get married if she went to jail. He has an example of a woman who had done £18 worth of damage with arson, who was sentenced to 1 month in jail, but a male embezzler was sentenced to 3 months of hard labor, even though he had a job lined up to repay the funds he had embezzled. There was a man who lived with an older woman that he was supporting, but he left when he found out she was a prostitute, but he was still prosecuted and given 1 month of hard labor, even though the judge recognized that the man was, quote, more sinned against than sinning. There was another case where a woman embezzled money and she pleaded for leniency because she was engaged and she had good character, and so did her fiancé. Aww. And then in general, even if a wife conceals pregnancy by another man at the time of marriage, that is not grounds for annulment. Bax says male criminals and non-criminals actually relate to the idea of moral value in the same way, that a male criminal does not believe his punishment is an injustice, and so he will avoid discussing right and wrong because it reminds him of his guilt. But that's not true of women. A woman will claim to be fully justified when she has, quote, committed the greatest conceivable infamy. A woman will express astonishment and indignation that anyone can doubt her perfect right to act as she has done. If anyone's seen Chicago,
they had it coming.
It's a exactly what Bax is talking about. I mentioned in my previous video that Bax had cited this book, Sex and Character, by Otto Weininger. Weininger says women are not naturally evil or anti-moral. They are amoral, that is, without moral. They lack a moral sense. So that women only feel remorse when they are put under external pressure or around others. Diana Davison actually did an amazing video about a woman who hired an assassin to kill her husband, but was caught, and then she was still trying to convince him that it was all somehow a mistake and it was all okay and she loved him and they should be together. He cites a doctor who says the natural maternal instinct is absent or weakened in the case of a woman who conceives by rape or where a woman was an unwilling participant in the sexual act. And this doctor justifies a woman strangling her 5-year-old son conceived by seduction by her employer by saying she lacks a maternal instinct because of the circumstances. And Bax asks what the maternal instinct has to do with murdering a child under your care. And finally, Bax discusses the idea that most advocates for women's suffrage are not militants, but they also have not repudiated the criminal tactics of the militants. That if they really found the behavior abhorrent and disapproved of it, they would at least mildly rebuke those militant methods. But they'll say, even though they're not militants, they're working toward the same goal. And the woman who is not a militant is always careful not to appear anti-militant. Even though they don't participate in unlawful acts, they are perfectly happy to reap the benefits of the acts of the militants. And I think this applies to the current SJW woke radical left movements, as well as the modern feminist movements. Although they're all kind of weird, orgiastic bedfellows at this point, shall we say. I think some of these stories are extreme, but they show the general idea that still applies today that women know that they can get away with crazy shit like hitting a man in public because everyone's gonna take their side. The things that women do that they would not be able to get away with if they tried to do them as a man is crazy. So once again, I oppose all feminism in my anti-feminist stance, even the early suffragettes, at least in the ideology and their tactics. So I just wanted to make a quick video to share some of those fascinating stories of female criminals and a little bit about female criminal treatment under the law according to Ernest Belfort Bax in the early 1900s in England. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you have any questions, please comment down below or send me an email. If you liked it, please give it a like. If you'd like to see more, please subscribe, and I hope to have more content for you very soon.